Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to another Ask Ian Q&A on Forgotten Weapons. I'm Ian McCollum, and our question today comes from Nicholas on Patreon. Nicholas asks, have there been any attempts to make miniaturized man-portable chain guns? Do you think there is a future for such a machine gun, given modern advances in energy storage? So, cool question. This is something we're going to have to tackle in a couple of different stages. So first off, what is a chain gun? Secondly, what does a chain gun allow you to do that other types of guns don't? And then thirdly, is this something that's likely to see further development? So first off, what is a chain gun? A chain gun is a specific type of externally powered machine gun. Of course, one of the fundamental advances in firearms technology, the thing that made Hiram Maxim such an important figure, was discovering how to practically harness the power of a cartridge to both propel the bullet and also cycle the action of a gun, thus allowing you to create a fully automatic self-powered gun. It's a really cool system from an engineering perspective that essentially your projectile is also your, for lack of a better term, your battery for making the gun function. Now, there are a couple different types of externally powered guns out there. Chain guns are one of them. Various types of rotary barreled things like miniguns are another. With a chain gun specifically, you actually have a physical chain that runs in essentially a square around the action. And it uses the external motor, typically, well, always an electric motor, to perform all the major functions that would be done by a gas operation system or a recoil operation system on a typical firearm. So it opens the bolt, it feeds a cartridge in, it closes the bolt, and then it holds the bolt locked, or keeps the bolt in a locked position, you know, engages a locking mechanism, while the gun fires. And this rotating chain, by altering the lengths of the different sides of the geometric path that the chain is following, you can do things like alter the rate of fire, you can alter how long the bolt remains locked after the gun fires, and that's important for a reason that we'll get to in a moment. And it's a nice system. It is almost always a single-barreled system, and that makes it a little bit distinct from the minigun-type systems, where you have a cluster of rotating barrels, and what the engine is doing, the electric motor is doing, is rotating that cluster of barrels, which then in turn mechanically operates a feeding system. So, what does this chain gun allow you to do that a regular machine gun can't? Well, the big thing is reliability. If you get a dud round in a regular machine gun, it's going to go click instead of bang, and then you're going to have to fix the system somehow. You're going to have to manually cycle the action. Usually that's enough. Maybe if something's deformed, you have to do something to clear the gun. In a mechanically operated gun, whether it's a chain gun or a minigun, a rotary Gatling gun, the action continues to cycle whether the cartridge fired or not. So if you have a dud round, the whole round just gets extracted out and then thrown out the ejection port or ejection tube, whatever it is, because that cycling of the gun is not dependent on energy coming from firing of the cartridge. This is the primary benefit of externally driven guns. They are for situations where either a malfunction is immediately really bad for the operator, or a situation where you simply don't have access to the gun to clear it, or where we see this the most is a situation where it's really, like, the gun is so big that it's not practical for a single operator to actually clear it. So these advantages come into play with things like helicopter-mounted guns. Well, if you have an AH-64 Apache, you've got a 30mm gun hanging off the bottom of the helicopter. If you have a dud round, you can't go climb out there and clear it. So either you have an externally driven system like a chain gun that can clear it by itself, or if you get a dud round, you're done using that gun until you go back to base and have a mechanic fix the gun. Situation where you could have a really serious impediment to the mission from a single dud round. On an infantry machine gun, if you get one dud round, it's not that big a deal. You just cycle it, clear it, and continue about your business. Second place where this is relevant are the really large caliber guns. We tend to see externally driven guns, especially chain guns, in 20, 25, 30 millimeter calibers, where the weight of the components is heavy enough. There's so much power in these cartridges that if you had to manually cycle the thing, it would be extremely difficult to do so, even if you had physical access. A good comparison to take note of here is like the 20mm Oerlikon guns from World War II, which were recoil operated. But if you had a misfire of some sort, in order to recock the gun, you basically had to hook a strap to the front end of the barrel and then use all of your body weight on the back end of the gun as leverage to crank the bolt back to recock it. You get above 20mm and it becomes basically impossible to do that sort of operation with just plain human muscle power. You need a mechanical assist to do it. And that's when things like mounted on a naval mount where you can actually access it. You put this on an airplane or a helicopter, obviously you can't get to it. So those are the, well, there's one other place where this is relevant. I said that you can control how long the bolt stays locked after the cartridge fires. One of the things that that allows you to do is dramatically reduce the amount of propellant gas that comes out the breech. If you hold that bolt closed until well after the bullet has left the muzzle, which isn't very short period of time in, you know, human terms. We're talking how many milliseconds is the thing closed. Well, if the pressure has dropped a lot by the time you open the bolt, there's very little gas left in the breech of the gun that can come out the back to, say, the firers. This is a thing that's of value for example, a tank machine gun, a coaxial tank machine gun, where if you have a lot of gas coming back out of the gun, it's going to fill up the crew compartment of the tank, and that's going to be bad. By deliberately delaying the opening of the bolt, you can minimize the amount of gas that comes back. And no coincidence, one place where we see chain guns actually used by a major military in just 30 caliber, one of the very few small caliber uses of them, is in a couple of British AFVs that use essentially the Hughes EX-34 chain gun, which in British service is the L-34A1, and they use it as an armored vehicle machine gun for exactly, well, for a couple of the reasons here, because you can cram it in a corner where you don't have to have easy access to clear it, because you won't need to, and also to prevent the vehicle from filling up with noxious propellant gases. So those are the benefits that you're going to get. Has anyone developed miniaturized chain guns? Sort of. As I just said, Hughes has a 30 caliber one that they've developed that is in military service, and it weighs about 30 pounds. So it weighs a bit more than a traditional machine gun. I should point out a couple of the advantages you do not get from a chain gun. One of the big ones is rate of fire. A chain gun is a single-barreled firearm, and so even if, hypothetically, you could use this mechanism and get it firing really fast, that one barrel is going to overheat, just like it would with any traditional firearm. And so that's an area where if you want a very high density of fire, a very high rate of fire, you are better off looking at a multi-barreled rotary system like a minigun. Although it's worth pointing out that the actual number of seconds you can fire a minigun with before it overheats is pretty much identical to the number of seconds you can fire any other single-barreled machine gun. The minigun has 6 barrels in it, the typical standard version, but it's also firing about 6 times as fast as a traditional gun. So each individual barrel is getting the same rate of fire through it that you would get in, say, a 500 to 1,000 round per minute machine gun of any other design. So, you know, the same number of seconds of firing gives you the same amount of heat in every barrel, but you get a lot more bullets out there in a very short time period with a rotary gun. Hence, it's better for very high volume of fire, very short duration things like aerial applications. Anyway, chain guns don't let you fire faster necessarily. What they give you is just that increase in absolute reliability, protection from dud cartridges. And there's also a benefit there if your ammunition is inconsistent. You're not going to get malfunctions that come from an overloaded or underloaded cartridge, because again, it's not the power of the cartridge that's actually cycling the action. It is an external independent electric motor that's cycling the action and doing it perfectly consistently every single time. All right, so the final part of the question, are we going to see development of more man-portable chain guns? I think the answer is probably no. I could see development of them for unmanned purposes. If you wanted to have a sentry type of gun that runs on its own sensors or remote control, that's potentially a place where a chain gun is valuable because you won't have a person there to fix it if something goes wrong. And in those sorts of applications, the absolute weight is probably not that important. An extra 5 or 10 pounds, not a big deal. For infantry use, I don't see this being something that's going to see more development because I don't think the trade-offs are worthwhile. In an infantry gun, weight is a significant consideration because someone has to carry the thing around, especially for a machine gun where you also have to carry all the ammunition for it. And you, by definition, have a person there who can fix a malfunction. So if you could take an M240, an FN mag, and say, you'll be immune to reliability malfunctions from these specific causes in exchange for adding 5 to 10 pounds to the gun, is that worth it? I don't think the trade-off is there. And I don't think it's really going to be possible to make a minigun lighter than a traditional machine gun, because that traditional concept of using the cartridge as the power source is a super cool, efficient idea. I think we've all gotten very used to this concept, and people don't tend to realize just how impressive it is that this is essentially a self-operating machine. If you want to get rid of that and go to an external power source, there's a bunch of extra mechanical stuff that you have to put on the gun. You're going to be able to get rid of a few bits, say a gas piston, but most of the rest of the action components have to stay there. You still need your locking system, you still need your bolt carrier, you're still going to need your trigger mechanism. Maybe the trigger mechanism can be simplified because it'll probably be electrical at this point, but whatever. But in exchange for this stuff, you have to add in things like the chain. And I have a hard time picturing a chain gun chain that's going to weigh less than the gas piston that it's replacing. So in theory, the action can become a little bit shorter because you don't have to have a recoil spring behind the bolt, because the bolt's being proactively operated by an electric motor. But of course, now you have to add an electric motor into the thing too. That's probably going to have some copper coils in it. That's going to be relatively heavy. So I don't think you can make a mini gun, a chain gun, say a 30 caliber or even a 5.56 caliber chain gun, weigh as little, you know, meet the same weight as a traditional machine gun. Then, of course, you have to add in that you're carrying both ammunition and a battery instead of your ammunition being the battery. So, with the exception of unmanned applications, I don't see it being that relevant. Now, for unmanned applications, if we're going to be talking about putting something like this on a drone, whether it's a ground-based drone or at some point an aerial drone, that there's definitely consideration for. There's potential there. Still, weight would be an issue, so there would be a motive to miniaturize, to lighten these things as much as possible, but that could actually happen. Will we see guys carrying them around with a backpack of ammo and a feed chute and a battery strapped to their, you know, web gear? That I doubt. Anyway, that was a really cool question, Nicholas. I think, as once again, that was a question that there's a lot more that goes into answering it than one might initially think. So that was a fun one to do. If you would like to have your question answered in a video format like this, please check out Patreon or Utreon. You can sign up there. You can help support Forgotten Weapons every day. And I have threads running on both of those platforms for Q&A questions each month. Thanks for watching. I'll see you next time.